So, for this video, there will be a total of 19 entries. The reason why it's 19 and not 22 as it should be is rather simple. Number 1, the Catholic monarchs Isabella I of Castile and Ferdinand II of Aragon are to be considered the same entry. And number 2, living kings will not be taken under consideration. This means that this guy and this guy will not be on the list. Capiche? We'll start from the union of both the crowns of Castile and Aragon and go until, well, the present day. Except for the kings still alive. Now, here we go. By the way, consider subscribing. 19. Ferdinand VII. So, in a general conversation with a Spaniard regarding their kings, on wondering which one is the worst, I went with what seemed to be the obvious answer to me, which was the inbred guy. Only for the Spaniards to tell me, actually we had worse. To which I responded, how? How can you get worse than the inbred guy? Turns out if you get a ruler who, throughout his tenure, lost the entire colonial empire of his country, followed by a civil war upon his death, you can apparently get a worse ruler than a guy you can't put two and two together. Literally. His rule was also marked by absolutism, which was so contested he couldn't even remain on the throne without French support. He's generally seen as a really incompetent and despotic ruler. 18. Charles II. Honestly, I just feel pity for the guy. He was the literal embodiment of every moment of my life is pain. His entire life was marked by his ill health, and pretty much everybody waited for him to die. It's actually astonishing he lived to the age of 38. To be fair, many of his physical and mental disabilities were probably exaggerated. People who actually talked to the man reported he was mentally capable, though he seemed to be prone to bouts of depression. Also, see this painting of his older sister. Look in the background. That's him as a child and probably the closest to how he actually looked without the painter's embellishment. His reign is generally seen as one of decline, and though some recent historians display a more balanced approach to his reign, I'm more inclined to take the side of the people who actually lived through his reign. One of whom apparently said it was incomprehensible for the monarchy to still keep going. 17. Charles IV, the father of Ferdinand VII. Never really cared for ruling, leaving state affairs to his wife and first minister, who were maybe, definitely, having an affair behind his back. Anyway, his reign was marked by his own ineptitude, as well as his ability to prove himself an untrustworthy ally to France, which led to Napoleon eventually getting sick of him, preferring to have him deposed and replaced by Napoleon's own brother. 16. Alfonso XIII, the last king of the monarch. Well, the old one, that is. Surprisingly, he is the only monarch to have ever been nominated to a Nobel Peace Prize. Anyway, as time passed, his impopularity rose, leading to, eventually, a point where not even the army was loyal to him, and he left the country for Rome. 15. Isabella II. Yet another monarch ousted from power. Man, all the way till World War II, Spain was constantly revolting. Her reign was marked by palace intrigue, conspiracies, military rebellions, and of course, a power struggle between Parliament and the crown. 14. Louis I. Don't have much to say about him, unfortunately. He was only the Spanish king for 7 months. 13. Philip I. His wife is more interesting than he is. Also, his wife was actually the ruling monarch. Philip was the Duke of Burgundy who happened to marry a Castilian princess who, by circumstance, happened to become the heir to the kingdoms of Castile and Aragon. In the midst of this, Philip schemed to actually seize the Castilian throne for himself, which he kind of did, until the day he suddenly dropped dead. He's also known as the Handsome, by the way. To be honest, I don't think so. 12. Juana I. The more I read about Spanish monarchs, the more I feel sorry for them, which is astonishing. I never thought I'd feel bad for royals. It's not like her reign is anything particularly noteworthy. Hell, throughout most of her time as queen, it was really her son, oh we'll get to him, who actually ruled Spain. But her personal life? It's quite frankly depressing. As a young woman, she was apparently very intelligent. So, for the unspeakable crime of thinking for herself and showing skepticism towards Catholicism, in Spain of all places, Juana was subjected to coercive punishment at the orders of her mother, which was known as la cuerda, meaning the rope, where she would be suspended in the air by a rope with weights tied to her feet. It probably isn't as pleasant as I'm describing. Later, she married the aforementioned Philip I, who attempted to seize her throne by besmirching her reputation. This is how her reputation as the Mad actually began. Naturally, this marriage was miserable on her part, and in reality, her madness was really just the typical symptoms you would find in clinical depression. Even after her husband died, she had no peace, as her son essentially took any royal power she had for himself, with pretty much no shame. 11th, Amadeo I. So, the Spanish ousted Isabel II from power and decided to choose a new king for themselves. After some issues regarding a certain German prince, the Spanish finally chose their king, and it was this guy. His coronation was marked by the assassination of his greatest supporter, so we're already off to a great start. His reign was marked by the very unstable Spanish politics, republican conspiracies, Carlist uprisings, assassination attempts, just to name a few. Not even 3 years in power, he just gave up being the King of Spain, abdicating from the Spanish throne, completely disgusted by his experience, and declaring the Spanish people to be ungovernable. You know what? I don't even blame him. The Spanish people are ungovernable. 10. Joseph I. Made King of Spain by Napoleon. This was so Napoleon could have a reliable puppet, with Joseph being his brother and all, rather than the very unreliable Bourbon dynasty, which just couldn't stop trying to switch sides during the Napoleonic Wars. But hey, Charles IV and his son were pretty incompetent rulers, so the Spanish people were pretty stoked to be led by that Bonaparte genius. Just kidding. They immediately revolted, positively vomiting at the fact that the French of all people had made their country a mere puppet. So naturally, Joseph was never really in control of the Spaniards, who promptly tried to ruin his reputation by calling him Joe Bottle for his supposed heavy drinking. An ironic accusation considering the fact Joseph didn't drink. The revolting period is known to us as the Peninsular War, and understandably Joseph wasn't very keen on ruling a country that absolutely despised him. In fact, he wasn't keen on ruling Spain, period, seeing as he was happy with his previous position as King of Naples, where he was in fact popular. He would abdicate from the Spanish throne as it became increasingly clear his position in Spain was not sustainable. Later in life, he moved to the US. 9. Philip III. Okay, so for starters, English historians have chewed out this guy hard, with descriptions of him being an undistinguished and insignificant man, a miserable monarch, and worst of all, a pallid, anonymous creature whose only virtue appeared to reside in a total absence of vice. The worst part is, they're not necessarily wrong. The truth is, Philip was well-educated, and polite, and by all accounts, a generally decent person, but was noted to have never been particularly intelligent. In other words, the type of guy to never have had an original thought in his entire life. His reign marks the Spanish Empire at its peak, and has other notable achievements such as temporary truce with the Dutch and Spanish entry in the 30 Years' War, though it is also marked by corruption and economic difficulties that mark the beginning of the decline of the Spanish Empire. 8. Philip IV. This one kind of angers me. Philip IV is known by the Spanish as the Great, and I thought he'd be considered as such by the Spanish. I had already covered him in my Portuguese King's rankings, and I assumed he'd be revered by the Spanish or something. Turns out he isn't. In fact, he's pretty average, if not mediocre. Then why is he called the Great? Anyway, though the Spanish Empire was gigantic at this point, it was very noticeably on the decline. And Philip didn't really prevent it or anything. In fact, he likely contributed towards it as he failed to properly reform the country, both domestically and militarily. Domestically, Spain at this point was really just a collection of kingdoms, each with their laws, customs, and taxation differing from one another. So he attempted to centralize power. This led to major revolts in Catalonia and Portugal. Catalonia's revolt was put down. Portugal's revolt wasn't, and as Portugal broke free, so did the Portuguese Empire. Militarily, Spain was also falling behind, as the Tercios, once dominant, were now proven to be increasingly inflexible in face of new formations. He also took a keen interest in the navy. Again, the end result was not as he wanted. When Philip was nearing his death, he expressed he hoped his surviving son, one Charles II, would be more fortunate than himself. Of course, we know that Charles II had never been fortunate, period. 7. Alfonso XII. He is already noteworthy for being a Spanish king in the 19th century that actually managed to die while on the throne, which is just astonishing. His reign was pretty short, just shy of 11 years, but it did establish the foundations for a socio-economic recovery period in Spanish history. This was achieved through some degree of political reforms as well as a victorious campaign against the Carlists. 6. Ferdinand VI. His reign is mostly marked by the reforms of the Marquis of Ensenada, forming the Giro Real Bank, I'm hoping I'm pronouncing this correctly, stimulating commerce in the Americas, raising the Navy's budget, and decreasing tensions with the Church, who was still very relevant in Spain. During his reign, Spain participated in the War of Austrian Succession, as well as the Seven Years' War, but really the main conflict was with Portugal due to some colonial land in the Americas. Things were settled by a deal between both nations. He was alright as king, but his reign was cut short as he rapidly lost his mental faculties, likely due to the death of his wife. It's been speculated he either fell into depression or his mental state declined due to a neurodegenerative disease of some sort. 5. Philip V. The first Bourbon to be the king of Spain. Philip V's reign was mostly marked by the War of the Spanish Succession, where he and Charles VI both claimed to be the rightful king of Spain. Philip won, of course, and his legacy is mixed. Historians have put forward that his government was really only slightly more advanced than that of his Habsburg predecessors, and that Philip usually favored France over Spain in matters of state. That being said, however, Philip did reform the government and straighten central authority, as well as making merit more important. The problem is, below the elite, the rampant corruption and inefficiency remained widespread. Still, the economy recovered, and his reforms did lead to much more significant reforms by Charles III, so his reign shouldn't be lumped in with likes of Philip III, Philip IV, or Charles II. 4. Charles I. This is where the list got really difficult. Choosing the top 4 wasn't really complicated, but the order, on the other hand, that's a different story. And we start with Charles I. He's more commonly known as Charles V, Holy Roman Emperor. To tell the truth, for a while during my life I was deeply interested in Charles V, sorry about the number, it's hard to change certain habits, as a historical figure. So I actually knew quite a lot about his reign before even beginning to make this video. If there's one thing that really pulls him down further is the fact that he was completely overstretched. Being the King of Spain, King of Naples, the Duke of Burgundy, the Archduke of Austria, and Holy Roman Empire all at the same time is inevitably going to wear you down, because it forces you to be everywhere at once. Which is what happened, and Charles ended his rule exhausted, abdicating in favor of his eldest son and younger brother. Ultimately, the Spanish tend to see him as a very medieval king, which is accurate. Under him, the Spanish Empire expanded massively, but that was really just a natural process of things. Charles didn't set up anything there. All the legwork had been done by the Catholic monarchs. With the constant French threat, the Ottoman excursion into Europe, and the Protestant Reformation, Charles V ultimately saw his reign as a failure, despite being a very capable individual. Ironically, it was with his abdication where he made the best possible decision he could have ever made, splitting his possessions in two, with Spain and the lowlands going to his son Philip, and Austria and the HRE going to Ferdinand. 3. Philip II. And finally we get to the black legend, the Anglo supervillain himself, Philip II. He is arguably the man who led Spain in its absolute peak, having had the Spanish conquest of the Inca Empire and the Philippines occur during his reign. He had essentially inherited his father's position as the defender of Catholic Europe against the Protestants and the Ottomans, though not having to deal with the affairs of the Holy Roman Empire gave him some liberties his father never had. This is not to say his reign is spotless. Inflation was rampant due to the absurd amounts of silver circulating in Spain, something he inherited from his father, and the government debt was staggering, to the point it defaulted 5 times during Philip's tenure as king. The Golden Age ain't free. This is all without mentioning the absurd amount of soldiers and resources spent fighting against his enemies, which weren't few. In the midst of all this, you may have noticed I have not mentioned the catastrophe of the Invincible Armada, and really though, that's because it was a fairly inconsequential event for Spain. The event itself is far more meaningful in English history. 2. Charles III. Having spent 25 years as the King of Naples, there was pretty much no other Spanish king as prepared for the job as Charles III. And it did show. This is the man who actually brought some proper rule into the Bourbon dynasty, before his son restarted the decline anyway. Anyway, with significant experience, Charles III made reforms far and wide as King of Spain, facilitating trade, modernizing agriculture, promoted science and research, strengthened the armed forces, and significantly increased the crown's revenue. And this is all without mentioning his reforms across the empire, which were also significant. It was also during his reign that Spain really became Spain. Before Charles III, Spain was seen as a collection of kingdoms held together by the same monarch, which was accurate to be honest. With Charles III, perception shifted to that of Spain being a nation-state. He's essentially the Spanish enlightened despot, in the same way as Frederick the Great of Prussia and Catherine the Great of Russia, and really, Spain has no one quite as him. He's truly a top-tier European monarch. And number one, the Catholic monarchs, Isabella I and Ferdinand II. At the very tippity top are the Catholic monarchs, the two people whose marriage literally created Spain. I'm fully aware that each were two separate individuals and quite capable on their own as well, but I honestly find it difficult to look at their reign separately. Of course, they completed the Reconquista, established the Spanish Inquisition, funded Christopher Columbus's voyage that led to the discovery of the New World, and established Spain as a major European power. Just to name a few of their most notable achievements. Their achievements are so deeply imprinted in the mythos of Spain, they're seen in pretty much the same regard as, say, Alfonso I in Portugal or William the Conqueror in England. Of course, they also managed to achieve this through a rather healthy relationship as partners, as both effectively followed a motto where the two saw each other as equal partners. To tell the truth, the Catholic monarchs were not originally my number one choice, but after giving it some thought, I truly couldn't put anyone over them. Not that I think any less of the other monarchs in the top four, they're all fantastic. But seeing as each were very capable rulers in their own right and that they imprinted themselves deeply into the Spanish mythos, I really couldn't see anyone else being number one. I hope you enjoyed this video, leave a like, leave your thoughts in the comment section below, and if you're not subscribed, then by all means do so, I'd really appreciate it. This was Spectrum, and I'll see you around.